Good morning. Welcome, everybody. Well, it's a blessing to be here, and it's a blessing as always, isn't it, to have a personal relationship with our Lord, with the God of the universe. And he wants to know us, and we want to know him. And it's just such a blessing to draw near to him, and we get a chance to do that this morning. So will you begin, please, by standing, and we'll sing his praises together.
Given a name. Him and perfect, spotless righteousness, the great unchangeable I am, the King of glory and of grace. One with himself I cannot die, my soul is purchased by his blood, my life is hid with Christ on high, with Christ my Savior and my God, with Christ my Savior and my God. With himself I cannot die, my soul is purchased by his blood, my life is hid with Christ on high, with Christ my Savior and my God, with Christ my Savior and my
have searched me, Lord, and you know me. You know when I sit and when I rise. You perceive my thoughts from afar. You discern my going out and my lying down. You are familiar with all of my ways. Before a word is on my tongue, you, Lord, know it completely. You hem me in behind and before, and you lay your hand upon me. Where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? If I go into the heavens, you are there. If I make my bed in the depths, you are there. If I rise on the wings of the dawn, if I settle on the far side of the sea, even there your hand will guide me. Your right hand will hold me fast.
When I fear my faith will fail, Christ will hold me fast. When the tempter would prevail, he will hold me fast. I could never keep my hold through life's fearful path, for my love is often cold. He must hold me fast.
of Hebrews, where we read God, after he spoke long ago to the fathers in the prophets and in many portions and in many ways, in these last days has spoken to us in his Son, whom he appointed heir of all things, through whom he also made the world. And he is the radiance of his glory and the exact representation of his nature, and upholds all things by the word of his power. When he had made purification of sins, he sat down at the right hand of the majesty on high. Amen. Let's have a seat. Grab your Bible, if you would, as we get started, and we're going to be looking at the Gospel of John, chapter 13, this morning. And as you're turning there, just to introduce where we want to be when we study God's Word, I hope that we take it seriously and that we consider it a great joy and a privilege to get to hear our Lord's words that he's given to us. And in this passage, we get words and a wonderful example from our Lord Jesus himself. And it's just the Gospel of John is a wonderful book. It really presents for us Jesus, the Word. The Word of God became flesh, dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory. And this book is an unfolding for us of the life and ministry of our Lord Jesus. And it's so rich and so applicable. I hope you're loving this book as much as I am. As we come to study it, we want to make sure that we're in the right spot where we can study God's Word and not have the essentially, going back to Old Testament terms, that idea of defilement, of sin, that, you know, as we just live our lives throughout the week, different things happen, and we don't always react the right way, and we recognize that our fellowship with God, our close relationship has become strained, and that it's our sin that is the problem, as we're going to see in this passage here this morning in John 13. So we'll take a moment for silent prayer. Anything that you need to take care of between you and the Lord, you can do that, and then we'll open up in prayer. So let's pray. Father, as we come this morning, we are aware always of your grace and how you deal with us graciously, far beyond anything that we could ever deserve, and certainly not in accordance with what we deserve. But you lavish your riches on us. You have treated us with your kindness. And Lord, we give thanks to you this morning for sending your Son Jesus Christ for us, that he would come and dwell on this earth, the King of the universe, the Prince of all eternity, coming down and becoming one of us, and living among us, dwelling among us. And Lord, we see his example this morning, and we are grateful for it, but we also ask, Lord, that you'd help us to take it seriously, that we would look to apply his example, his teachings, his words to our lives. Father, we give you thanks this morning for who you are and how you work. May we behold the splendor and the majesty of our Lord Jesus this morning, as he had the confident assurance of his coming glorification on the other side of the horrific crucifixion that he would have to endure. Lord, may we recognize us who live post-cross, what was done for us. And Lord, we celebrate this morning our Lord Jesus Christ, the triumphant one, the one who in whom is all glory, and whose glory was revealed, and who glorified you through the accomplishment of that mission that he was sent to accomplish. Lord, we ask this morning that you would help us to focus in on you, to concentrate on your word, that we wouldn't get sidetracked by the various things swirling around us, the things that weigh on us, the things that distract us, the things that worry and concern us. But Lord, help us to not have worry and concern because of our recognition of who you are, your greatness, your power, your ability, your provision, and Lord, that you are taking care of us at all times. Father, we ask that we would also be looking to support and walk alongside one another as brothers and sisters in Christ, as members of the body of your Son, Jesus Christ. Lord, thank you for the gift that we have of the local church, the gift that you've given us of a church family. Not only do we get to have our individual families, but a church family as well. We ask that you would draw us near to one another, that you would increase our fellowship and our camaraderie, and that you would give us the joy of that coming together in fellowship, and as we do so next week around the communion table as well. Lord, bless this passage that we have in front of us. We ask that you would teach us what it has for us and that you would use it, that it would go forth mightily and powerfully as your words, and that we would be richly blessed by it. We ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, as we begin this morning, I want to just recap briefly where we came from last week. And we're not going to spend a lot of time on there, but just to kind of tie it together, you'll notice in John chapter 12, if you're looking maybe right across the page or just up a verse, that John chapter 12, verse 50 ended with this: I know that his commandment is eternal life. Therefore, the things I speak just as the Father has told me. So in the verse right before us, we unfortunately have a chapter break here, but it's a continuation of Jesus' teaching. We left off with him saying that what I speak are not my words. I'm not just coming up with stuff. I'm not speaking of my own initiative, but I'm speaking the exact words that the Father has given to me. So God the Father there is prominent in verse 50. And then we're going to pick up in the very next verse this morning, chapter 13, verse 1. Now before the feast of Passover, Jesus, knowing that his hour had come, that he would depart out of the world to the Father, having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. So you can see that this continued focus on God the Father will continue this morning where we left off last week. We noted last time that the verses we covered, and additionally a couple more, basically John chapter 12, verses 35 through 50, that whole section is essentially a summary or a thumbnail version of the entire book of Isaiah that we see being brought out in some of those citations there in those verses, which come from Isaiah chapter 6 and Isaiah also chapter 53 as well, in the context there, bringing us back to Isaiah, drawing that connection for us. And we saw how that factored in powerfully to how we interpret this passage of Scripture and what that reveals for us. We noted that in these verses, the word believe is a key word. It occurs 8 times throughout these 14 verses. But sadly, the belief that we see is actually unbelief, that the people of Israel, the nation as a whole, refused to believe. They beheld Jesus with their own eyes. They saw him, they heard from him, they talked to him. They saw his miracles. They heard his teachings, yet through all of it, they continued in their unbelief as a whole, as a people. Also, last time, that brought us to verse 39, where we saw that there was a tragedy. The tragedy of the people of Israel was a continuation of that which Isaiah predicted. It was true of the nation of Israel in his day, this is hundreds of years before Jesus, that it was a people who was hard-hearted and who would continue in unbelief and would reject the Lord. And he predicted that this would happen in the future as well. And so Jesus makes the point that what happened in his own life and ministry in Jesus' day should not be surprising. The point isn't that God made them disbelieve, we noted last time, but rather that we shouldn't be surprised by their disbelief because it was predicted, it was prophesied that it would happen that way many, many years before it ever happened. We looked at verse 40, and in verse 40 we read, "He has blinded their eyes," these are the words of Isaiah, "and he hardened their heart, so that they would not see with their eyes and perceive with their heart and be converted, and I heal them." Verse 41, "These things Isaiah said because he beheld his glory and he spoke of him." So we noted there that with the Jewish nation, we see their rejection, and we see that the message and the miracles resulted in their eyes being blinded, their ears being shut, their hearts being hardened. They closed themselves off to the glory of God that was revealed to them, what he showed himself, what he taught them. So we saw this inherent connection between hardening and glory. Both come from the same Hebrew root, kavod, and it's this idea of weightiness or significance. And significantly, as God manifests his glory, or we could say as he provides clear and direct revelation of himself through his testimony of his word, through the demonstration of his power, people are left with only two choices. There's only two ways to respond. One is humility, to believe. The other is arrogance, to not believe, or we could say to reject. And so that response is followed up by how, if the people or if an individual hardens their heart, then God may go on to harden their heart even further. They've shut themselves off and also set themselves up for judgment based on the revelation they've received of God's glory. More revelation would make their judgment more severe, and so that God may, in his mercy, cut that revelation off, hardening their heart against further revelation. So it's a response to God's glory. What do we do with God's glory revealed? And that's the age-old question. With that, with a hard-hearted response, God may harden the heart further. And in an extreme instance, you might think of someone like Pharaoh, who really was extremely arrogant and proud and thought the world of himself and hardened his heart again and again. How God then basically got to the point where he said, okay, you have seen my glory, Pharaoh, manifested in incredible ways. The 10 plagues were designed to get his attention, and yet they didn't. It just hardened him further in his rejection. And so finally, God's what he does with Pharaoh is he basically uses him as a tool that he's going to use to reveal his glory in an even greater way at the time of the Exodus. And sometimes God may do that. The manifestation of his glory for someone who is completely rejecting, he may just do it anyway in an even greater fashion through the hardness of the heart of the person who then he hardens even further. That takes us up to where we are going to pick up this morning. John chapter 13, and this passage is one, you can see the title of the message is Jesus, the greatest servant of all. And this is the passage that you've possibly read before, likely read before at some point. You remember it from Sunday school, where Jesus, there in the upper room, shortly before his crucifixion, washes the feet of his disciples. Go ahead and read through our passage here. Now, before the feast of the Passover, when Jesus knew that his hour had come, that he should depart from this world to the Father, having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. And supper being ended, the devil having already put it into the heart of Judas Iscariot, Simon's son, to betray him, Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands, and that he had come from God and was going to God, rose from supper and laid aside his garments, took a towel and girded himself. After that, he poured water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and to wipe them with the towel with which he was girded. Then he came to Simon Peter, and Peter said to him, Lord, are you washing my feet? Jesus answered and said to him, what I am doing you do not understand now, but you will know after this. Peter said to him, you shall never wash my feet. Jesus answered him, if I do not wash you, you have no part with me. Simon Peter said to him, Lord, not my feet only, but also my hands and my head. Jesus said to him, he who is bathed needs only to wash his feet, but is completely clean. and you are clean, but not all of you. For he knew who would betray him. Therefore, he said, you are not all clean. So, again, a well-known story. I wanted to just begin with something kind of funny from yesterday. As we think of, you know, your feet getting dirty, I experienced this a lot when I was over in Africa. All the streets, virtually all the streets, except for maybe some main highways that were paved, were all dirt. And, you know, we would typically, because it was a hot climate, wear like flip-flop sandals around. And I felt like my feet were never not dirty. You know, for the entire time I was there, my feet were always dirty because everything was just dirt and dust constantly everywhere. And it was not something you could ever escape. And that is the exact situation there in Jerusalem. The streets were dirt. Everything was dirty and messy, and it was unavoidable. And yesterday at our house, our youngest daughter, Elsie, she gets a shout-out this morning. She never makes it into my sermons. So I'll give her a little shout-out today. So yesterday, the girls were at the airport for an air show, and Elsie was all around running, toddling around on the tarmac. And she apparently had flip-flops on, but somehow managed to get black, dusty asphalt all over her feet, combined with dirt from running through the dirt, and her feet, by the time she got home, were filthy. So we're thinking, okay, you know, we're returning home. We need to give this child a foot bath. Let's get her into the bathtub. But before we got her feet in the bathtub, she escaped over to the neighbor's house. Well, our next-door neighbors apparently had the same reaction that we did and said, this girl's feet are filthy. They can't be in our house. So she returns home, and her feet are clean. And we say, Elsie, what happened to your feet? Oh, they gave me a foot bath. Well, thank you. What kind neighbors. And sure enough, they stepped in and gave her a foot bath. So she came home with clean feet, and I was like, Elsie, you're helping with my sermon. This is awesome. So this account of Jesus washing the disciples' feet is, I would say, probably the most, arguably the most profound concept in the Bible. Jesus, we noted last time, he came to fulfill that imagery in Isaiah of the suffering servant. Isaiah chapters roughly 50 through 53, Jesus, the suffering servant. And the second word is key in that. He was a servant. He came to serve. He was the servant of Jehovah, God the Father. He came as his servant to do his will. But in the midst of that, he comes to this earth, and we see him again and again and again serving others, and in a variety of ways, big ways and small ways, and in this case, a very unexpected way. So as we see this concept, I just wanted to mention something quickly. When I graduated a couple of years ago from seminary, they gave us three things at our seminary graduation. There was, you know, I don't know, a couple hundred students in this auditorium, and we walked up, and, you know, you get to shake hands with the different professors that you've had, and finally the president of the college, and then you're handed three things. We got handed a Bible, a brand new Bible. We got handed our diploma, giant diploma, supersized, and then this little towel. I'll show you this. It has John 13:15 on it. There's what that looks like. And I'll just read that verse. It'll be coming up in next week's passage. But it says, as Jesus washed his disciples' feet, he said to them, I have set you an example that you should do as I have done for you. And so they encouraged us as new graduates to go forth and to be servants after the example of Jesus, who washed the feet of his disciples. And so we're going to talk about that this morning here in this passage. So let's look at our first verse, verse 1. Come on, PowerPoint. There we go. Now, before the Feast of Passover, so what we're dealing with is in the context of putting this all together. This would be in the upper room setting On Thursday, the Passover takes place Friday, but it would be Thursday evening, probably after sunset, that the Passover meal would be eaten. So all the disciples are all gathered. They've come to this celebration. When Jesus knew that his hour had come, that he should depart from this world to the Father, having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. Now, when we look at the context, there's this Passover celebration, and it would be celebrated in Jerusalem at a set time of the year, a time that we would associate with Easter, Resurrection Sunday. That for us has gotten cemented in our calendar around the same time as Passover. That's not a coincidence. That's come out of this entire imagery and setting. And so a Passover meal, Passover Seder, would be eaten with one's family, close family, extended family, close friends. It was a gathering. It was a holiday. It was a big occasion. And they were going to share a nice meal in common. There would be a Passover lamb that they would eat the Passover lamb, as well as these other elements of the Passover Seder. I don't know if you remember a few years ago when Olivier Melnick from Chosen People Ministries was up here, and he had the table, and it was all spread out with all these really interesting little jars and herbs and all kinds of different things. And he went through and he explained the Passover Seder to us. And this is what Jesus and the disciples are about to enjoy. This is a big deal. This is a big occasion. This is, kind of their Thanksgiving meal. This is their highlight of their calendar year as far as their worship calendar goes. And in that sense, it actually started their year. So they gather here in Jerusalem. Jerusalem is full of people. It's swelled in its population. And Jesus makes the arrangements. He says, you're going to go and you're going to ask to use this upper room. You're going to find everything you need to celebrate the Passover. He gives his disciples these instructions. And so they go and they start making the preparations. But Jesus, this is important, he's the host. So they're coming to his celebration. They're going to wash up. They're going to put on clean clothes. They're going to get ready to go to this dinner. They're excited to get together with Jesus, not knowing. Obviously, there's a lot of tension in Jerusalem, and Jesus is public enemy number one. But at the same time, there's this anticipation of the feast, and they get to celebrate it with Jesus. And so it says, now before the Passover. And this is a key indicator, this phrase for us. It tells us what we've already read in the preceding verses, that Jesus, and it says here, his hour had come. His time had come. His death is now really, really imminent. The disciples don't yet seem to understand all that entails, but they're here. They're present. But what we see from Jesus here, first of all, in these first three verses, we're going to read the focus being on what Jesus knew. And then in verses 3 and 4 and 5, the emphasis and following, it's on what Jesus did, his personal example. So we begin with what Jesus knew. And so he knew that there was his ministry, there was the crowds, there was the disciples. He was about to essentially have nothing. He was on the verge of having his ministry gone. The big crowds, gone. His disciples fleeing, not around. His popularity, gone. His very life, gone. He knew in reality that he had, in contrast to this, he had everything through his Father. The highlight goes back, the focus goes back to God the Father. Jesus knew that he actually had everything, and it was on account of his identity, who he was, who his Father was, where he came from, and where he was going to return back to heaven. So, and he also knows the end result of all this, that through this process, there's going to be a tremendous glorification as he completes his mission. So Jesus, essentially everything on the surface looks gloomy and terrible. But Jesus recognizes that through this, he has everything and that he is going to have everything. So we could say that Jesus has control over this situation. He has a full understanding and knowledge of what's going on. Everything is under complete control. It doesn't look that way, but we're told that from Jesus' standpoint, he knows that it is. We're told what he knows. Let's look at our first takeaway right here. Jesus had a lot of confidence going into this. It wasn't that he was looking forward to it. He was actually dreading what he would have to go through, but he understood the point, and he understood his mission, and he understood his responsibility, his duty as a servant, and what it was going to accomplish, and all of this gave him tremendous confidence. God's desire for each one of us also is that we would share that same confident assurance that Jesus had. Because of the certainty of our faith and our true identity, we also know that we have all things through Christ. Do you reflect on that? Do you know that? Do you know what you have in Christ? It's powerful. So God's will for each one of us is that we will translate that boldness into faith. And that faith, that confidence, into following Jesus' example of serving others out of confident humility. And that's probably how I would summarize this whole concept of what we're looking at, is confident humility, confidence that is rooted in faith and that translates into service. And this gets really profound as we start to look into it. So Jesus, we're told at the end of verse 1 here, we'll flip back here, is that he knew he was going to depart from this world, and it said he loved his own who were in the world. Who is this his own? His own is his disciples. So Jesus loved the Father, he loved the world, and we're told here specifically that he loved his disciples. And how did he love them? The word here is aistelos. So it's either to the end, like all the way to the very end of his ministry. Or this phrase, they're not sure. I looked at a lot of Greek experts on this. Some believe it's better rendered to the utmost. Or you could say maybe to the maximum. That'd be another way of rendering this phrase in Greek. So it's either all the way to completion, all the way to the end, or it's to the epitome, to the utmost, to the maximum. Verse 2. Come on, PowerPoint. It doesn't like me this morning. And supper being ended, the devil having already put it into the heart of Judas Iscariot, Simon's son, to betray him. So this phrase is actually not best rendered and supper being ended, but actually what we would say in probably more contemporary language would be at dinner time. So at dinner time, the things are getting ready to be served. The meal is at hand on this Thursday evening. And the focus here goes on to Judas. He's one of the 12 disciples who's present in this room. And of course, you and I know a lot about this Judas figure, this Judas guy. But the other 11 disciples really didn't. They're still, at this point, they're kind of in the dark. They don't have the same information that we do about Judas and what he's been up to thus far. What we're told is that Judas has already been influenced by Satan to betray Jesus already by this point. Now, when you think of, it says the devil having put it into the heart of Judas Iscariot, something to stop and to focus on for a second here is this idea of satanic or demonic influence. And that's an important concept to understand. It's spoken of elsewhere in the New Testament as, you know, Satan's fiery darts that he likes to fire off at believer and unbeliever alike. We as believers have the full armor of God, according to Ephesians, and we have the shield of faith, and we have a defense mechanism against those attacks of Satan that unbelievers do not have. There is another concept that is spoken of in the Gospels, and that is demonizomai. It's being possessed by a demon. We don't really see this going on much beyond the Gospels. It seems to have been a particular something that was happening in particular during Jesus' earthly ministry, where people would actually become demon-possessed. I believe that it still can happen today, of course. But it seems to have really been pronounced during Jesus' ministry. He had a lot of hostility, a lot of opposition around him from the demonic realm. But the question is, can believers be demonized, demon-possessed? And I believe the answer has to be no, because that would be so contradictory to our being indwelt by God's Holy Spirit, that we have a natural protection against that, to where we cannot be possessed by a demon as believers. But can we be demon influenced? Absolutely. And those whispers and those attacks and those fiery darts hit us all the time. And so we do need to be aware of that occurrence. But here we have Judas, an unbeliever. Judas was not born again. Judas had not trusted in Jesus Christ the way all the other disciples had. And so Judas was very vulnerable. And Satan had actually entered into him and implanted this idea in him, and he had just gone right along with it. And he was already of the mind of betraying Jesus. It fit right along with Judas' self-absorption and his personal ambitions and desires. And once Satan spoke those words in his ear, he was off to the races. Verse 3, Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands, and that he had come from God and was going to God. So again, this focus on what Jesus knows. There's a lot of things that Jesus knows. He knows that his hour has come. He sees all the pieces coming together, and he knows what's happening. He knows that he's going to depart out of this world and go back up to the Father. He knows that he's loved by the Father. He knows that the Father has given all things into his hands. He knows where he's come from. He knows what Judas is up to. And it's interesting that when we put all this together, it was Jesus' knowledge that he had been given all things by his Father, that he had come from the Father, and that after his death he would return to his Father, that caused Jesus to do something unusual, as we're going to see in the very next verse, to put himself in the place of an ordinary servant. You might think, well, if he's got this confidence, if he's got this all this knowledge built up, shouldn't that embolden him to be the one who is ordering everyone else around and being served? But curiously, it has the exact opposite effect. It causes Jesus to put himself in the place of a servant. He didn't assume the role of a servant out of weakness or lack of other options, but instead out of his confident assurance, his total boldness, a position of absolute strength, and certain faith in his coming glorification. I haven't been able to completely wrap my mind around this yet, but this is a very profound concept, that the King of all the universe, the one who came from heaven, who had all power and glory, is fully aware of who he is, and it translates into him taking the place of a servant, one that people would typically associate with weakness and with lack of status and being, you know, just kind of there. Okay, verse 4. And it says, Jesus, here's where we see his action start, what Jesus did. It goes from what he knew to what he did. He rose from supper, laid aside his garments, took a towel and girded himself. So this is his love being displayed through humility, being put in action in order to demonstrate, we're told of his love for his disciples, that it was to the utmost. Now we're going to see it put into practice. At a dinner such as this Passover, usually it was the host. That was the custom. The host would line up a servant or, you know, the somebody they could hire nearby to take care of the obvious need of all the guests, and that was the foot washing. It was, you know, something where if one of the guests had to take that responsibility, that would be considered very unfortunate for that guest. All present would actually be insulted by the lack of hospitality, or at least by the host dropping the ball and failing to plan to make the necessary arrangements for foot washing. And washing of feet was considered a very menial task. It was what was be done by the hired help. It was not something respectable. It was just something that you hired out. So here it's striking to consider what Jesus was about to endure. He, you know, you think through what he was about to endure, how he must have been feeling on the inside. These are very difficult circumstances. And in spite of all that he was going through personally and internally, that he would take it on himself to tend to the needs of others. That's profound. All the inner turmoil that he's going through, that he would focus on others, even as sinful and unworthy and undeserving as they were, and that we know that they were. You know, think through the disciples. There was Jesus' disciple Judas, who was going to betray him. There was Peter, who was going to deny him. There was Thomas, who was going to doubt him. He knew it all. So what is Jesus wearing? What is he doing? What's going on here? We can infer that when Jesus took off his outer garments, that when we look at Jesus' crucifixion a little bit later on, there was a garment that he normally wore that was considered desirable by the Roman soldiers, so much so that they cast lots to see who would get it because they all wanted it. It was described as an outer garment, an outer tunic that was finely woven, and it was seamless. That would mean it was unusually costly. We're not told how Jesus got this garment. It could have maybe been a gift that somebody gave him at some point during his ministry. He also would have, over that, worn a shawl with blue tassels that would be the garment of a rabbi. And we're told about that in Matthew 9, verse 20. There's those tassels, and the woman with the bleeding disorder comes along, and she just touches the tassel of his garment. That would be these blue tassels of his rabbi's shawl, and she was instantly healed. So these would be Jesus' normal outer garments that he would wear around, one costly and the other authoritative as a rabbi. So Jesus takes these off. And at this point, he's wearing only his inner tunic, so kind of basic clothing at this point. And he wraps around himself a lenteum, is the word here in Greek. It is this piece of fabric, long linen cloth used by a servant. It would be functionally similar to how we would wear an apron. When I worked at in the hospitals, one of the things that was kind of a necessity when you were working in the kitchen was to wear an apron. Not only did it protect your clothes from splatters if you were cooking soup or whatever, but it was also, it really came in handy because if you needed to carry, let's say, a whole bunch of those little cartons of milk all at once, you could just load them in there and carry them, and you didn't have to stop and make a whole bunch of trips. So it was a worker's garment. It was something that had a functional, practical purpose. Going along with this word, one of the things that we read from the Roman historian Suetonius is that the emperor, the Roman emperor Caligula, liked to notoriously make some of his senators wait at his table with one of these linen cloths, this lenteum, in order to demonstrate his power over them as he basically belittled them in front of others. You think you're a powerful senator in the Roman Senate? Why don't you come be my servant? You know, he loved to just play these games with people. And so Jesus, I like this quote from Dwight Pentecost. He says, "How fitting that Christ should have laid aside his robe of honor and put himself in a servant's place." Thinking through these dinner guests, their tables were not like ours, you know, where you pull up a chair and sit down. The table was much lower, and they would recline at the table on a kind of leaning on a pillow, and so their feet would be kind of fanning out away from the table. And this presents an obvious problem because their feet are filthy. They've just walked across town. The baths were usually a public bath, a mikvah. They'd go and they'd bathe. They'd be all nice and fresh and clean. But then they'd walk through these city streets, and by the time they got to their destination, their feet were disgusting. And, you know, you think about dirty streets. Dirt is one thing. But during Passover, when there's just sheep going everywhere, you know, the dung on the streets would be everywhere, and they wouldn't have been able to avoid it. And so that's the condition as they arrive in the upper room. They're clean, but their feet are filthy. This quote by Warren Wiersbe: "The Father had put all things into the Son's hands, yet Jesus picked up a towel and a basin." You see this, this humility. And I believe that this concept is so profound, what Jesus is about to do. That this humility, this taking on the role of a servant in whatever that means, is key, is absolutely critical. So often when we hear of those in ministry that have, you know, gone through some kind of a failure, you know, it just, a lot of times it's a scandal, it makes public news. Maybe it's more personal. You've experienced this kind of thing in a church ministry setting, and it's devastating. So many times what happens is that the ministry is successful, or in a professional setting. Some of you, you know, have worked in different environments. You see someone attain professional success, and eventually comes a lack of humility. And I think that that's what so often precedes those ministry and moral failures. It's that, you know, success that gains being served by others, and a sense of being entitled to be served and having status and being served by those are the world's hallmarks of success. I read this. I thought it was helpful. It has to do with leadership and the scene of Jesus washing the disciples' feet. This comes from pastor in Texas, or an elder, I'm not sure his role exactly. His name is Bob Deffenbaugh. He always has wonderful things to write about Scripture. He says, "Jesus has washed the feet of the disciples purposefully. It was a task that needed doing, and our Lord did it. It was also a way that Jesus could demonstrate his unfathomable love for his disciples. But beyond this, it was a lesson which the disciples desperately needed to learn, a lesson in humility. These men were still looking at leadership from a secular perspective rather than from a divine perspective. The secular world looks upon leadership as the opportunity to be served. A leader has many people under him, and thus he uses them to minister to his own needs. In the kingdom of God, a position of leadership is simply a place of service. No matter where one finds himself on the leader-follower scale, the Christian is to serve God by serving others. Leadership is simply one place of service. It enables one to serve as others cannot. And it is where God has uniquely placed you to serve. It could be at Calvary Baptist Church in Brewster, Washington. It could be leading a corporation. It could be out there as an athlete or a coach or whatever leadership position or setting God puts you in. That's where he has placed you, and that's where you're called to serve. Let's move on to five. "After that, he poured water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and to wipe them with a towel with which he was girded." So Jesus takes on this foot washing. He puts himself in the place of a servant. And you can picture the disciples seated around the table. And from what we know of these settings in the past, the disciples are usually trying to get a little closer to Jesus. They're trying to show that they have a little more status than each other. They're jockeying for position. They're at times arguing about who is sort of the leader of the group and who's moving up in Jesus' camp and who's setting themselves up for what position in the kingdom. And, you know, when Jesus' kingdom gets set up, we want to make sure we're ready. And, you know, they're always kind of in this position of wondering who is outflanking them, who is moving up faster than them, who is achieving greatness more than them. And so probably in this setting around the table, their seating arrangements are even reflecting this. And Jesus goes around and he stoops down and he starts washing their feet, drying them with this linium towel wrapped around him. And you can just picture that finally he gets around to wherever Peter is seated. We don't know which disciple he started with. But as Peter sees this happening, he has this response. Then he came to Simon Peter, and Peter said, "Lord, are you washing my feet?" Or we might render this, "Lord, you're going to wash my feet?" Peter is obviously caught off guard, as much as all the other disciples. It's always interesting how John records this, because John is right there in the midst, and he's one of the disciples, and they're presumably oftentimes thinking the same thing, having the same reaction. John doesn't necessarily single himself out, but he apparently wasn't saying anything different. Peter is just always the vocal one. Peter is the one who's going to speak up. He's always kind of that first one to speak his mind, and that's what he does here. And he implies this with this question. This is kind of a loaded question that Peter asks. He implies that Jesus doesn't know what he's doing and that what he's doing is not acceptable, which begs the question, when does God not know what he's doing, or when does God ever do something that's not acceptable? So I think if Peter was in his right mind here, he could have caught himself and realized, oh, yeah, I think I'm a little bit outmatched here. But Peter doesn't have that response, sadly. Let's look at verse 7. Jesus answers Peter. He says to him, "What I am doing, you do not understand now, but you will know after this." So, Peter basically says, "Jesus, you don't understand. You don't know what you're doing. That's the role of a servant. This is not the way this works. If anything, I should be washing your feet. You're the rabbi. You're the teacher. I sit at your feet. I should be washing your feet." And he basically comes at it as Jesus doesn't understand what he's doing. And Jesus says, "Peter, you don't understand what I'm doing. But you will know after this." After, there's going to come a time, after Jesus' resurrection, when it's all going to be an aha moment for Peter and he's going to put it all together. What Jesus wants for Peter here in this instance is that when Peter can't understand, Jesus wants him to trust. And that's probably the hardest thing in the world for all of us, isn't it? When we can't understand and God's call for us is to trust him. Now at this point, from Peter's standpoint, the proper response would have been for Peter to accept, to trust, most importantly, to stop talking. He could have just said, "Okay." But, you know, Peter, so often, like someone who hasn't yet learned to bite his or her tongue, he just continues protesting instead of trusting. I would say that it actually takes a lot of humility for all of us to bite our tongue when needed. And it takes even more humility to trust when we don't understand. And I think this is the major lesson of this entire section that we need to make sure we catch. This is the unfolding of this object lesson. So many times in Scripture, the most important thing is our response to God working. Now, in culture, we have a saying that life is 10% what happens to us and 90% how we respond to it. And I think that's true. But even more so where God is concerned, I would say it's 0% what happens to you and 100% how you respond to him. So So Peter doesn't get it right here. He doesn't bite his tongue. He doesn't just say, okay. He doesn't just trust. He's going to answer back. And he says, you shall never wash my feet. Ume in the Greek. A very strong negation. The second strongest negation in Greek. No way. You are not going to wash my feet. Jesus answered him, if I do not wash you, you have no part with me. So Peter, you know, we don't want to delve too far into his psyche, but he either has a desire to genuinely be humble, or he wants to come across as looking humble, or maybe he has this desire to try to help Jesus save face. He doesn't want him to look bad in front of others. He doesn't want him to do something so inappropriate for someone so great. Whatever is going on in Peter's mind, though, his desire to project humility gets immediately canceled out by his rejecting Jesus' act of service and then telling Jesus what he can't do. And that's not humble at all. And this is Peter's initial wrong response to continue talking instead of accepting and trusting that's going to lead to this unfortunate situation here in verse 8 where Peter actually rejects Jesus' act of service. Imagine, Jesus wants to serve Peter and Peter says no. I think that we can take that a step further. And we can say that where this is all leading is to the cross. And the greatest act of service of Jesus' entire life and ministry and time on earth is when he goes to the cross. And he's going to lay down his life in service of you and me and everyone in the entire world, yet so many people are going to say, no, I don't want it. And that's a tragedy. Verse 9, Simon Peter said to him, Lord, not my feet only, but also my hands and my head. So just like, you know, all of us, what we're wearing clothes, the exposed part of our body would be our head and our hands. And he says, everything, you know, every skin that's exposed, wash that too. And you see Peter, he goes right from telling Jesus what he shouldn't be doing and that what he's not going to do to telling him he should do even more. He just completely swings from one end to the other wildly. Peter's brashness leads to this nonsensical statement, and it's rooted in his willingness to, I would say, first of all, instruct Jesus, and second of all, put demands on Jesus. Both of those are problematic. I would say this is precisely what we as followers of Jesus should never do. Nevertheless, Jesus, in his grace, he answers Peter not harshly. Instead, he uses this as a teaching moment. A teaching moment where he's going to explain that there's a deeper meaning to what he's doing. There's a purpose behind what he's doing. There's a rationale. There's a why behind the what of washing the disciples' feet. He uses this ordinary part of Jewish life there in Jerusalem to teach spiritual truth. I like this quote here from Disciple Makers Multiplied. When we are wrong, and this is kind of highlighting what's going on with Peter, it's wise to simply admit it and avoid these all-or-nothing statements. The Lord was not impressed. Sometimes that's the hardest thing to do in the world, is that when we recognize we're wrong, to simply admit it. And I'm trying to, as a soccer coach, instill some of these lessons in the kids. And I want them to understand it's, you know, being a leader, being mature, is not about not making mistakes. It's what you learn from them or don't learn from them. And one of the best things you can do is to take ownership. When you mess up, just say, yep, I messed up. I didn't do well on that. I didn't handle that situation right. I'm going to fix it going forward. And with God's help, all things can be fixed going forward. And everything can become a rich teaching moment like this, an opportunity for growth. Let's look at verse 10. Jesus said to him, he who is bathed needs only to wash his feet. A different word here, bathed. And it's obviously, it communicates a bath. needs only to wash his feet. Jesus said to him, I'll read the whole thing again. He who is bathed needs only to wash his feet, but is completely clean. And you are clean, but not all of you. So he's taking this concept and he's applying it to the disciples who have all bathed, but yet he says, one of you is not clean. He says, you're clean, but not all of you. And then he's going to hone that down a little bit in verse 11. So verse 10, we have this external foot washing, that was a picture of inner spiritual cleansing from the defilement of sin. So something that happened all the time, every day, everywhere they would walk, their feet would get dirty. It was a normal part of everyday life. So here's our second takeaway, keeping our feet clean. The very nature of walking in the world, in literally the dirty streets of Jerusalem, or for us, just our existence in this world, walking about, going about life, means that our feet constantly get filthy. If we have defiled feet, we cannot have fellowship with God. That's what Jesus is saying here in verse 8. If I don't wash you, you have no part with me. We can't have close fellowship if you've got these filthy, defiled feet. It's, you know, he's using it for a metaphor, a teaching illustration. So God's will for each of us is that we keep our feet washed. In other words, when we become defiled by sin, we must confess it to God. You know, this concept of confession of sin is something we try to keep at the forefront here in this church ministry. And I hope that we do make constantly an emphasis on this because Jesus does. It's important, and maybe some of you, I know some of you have come out of a Roman Catholic background. And in the Catholic Church, confession is a thing. It is, you know, there's a confessional, and there's a priest who has times where people can come and they can confess their sins, and it is a prominent concept within the Roman Catholic Church. And that's a good thing. Where we have a disagreement is the mechanism, because in the Catholic Church, the belief is that it has to go through a priest because an individual doesn't have that kind of direct access to take care of that on an individual basis before the Lord, that the confession needs to go through a middleman, through a priest, and we say no, that we have a high priest who died for us and is there as our mediator, and we have direct access to God the Father, and we can come to him directly with the confession of sin. But we want to keep that defilement away. We want to keep that fellowship close. So I like how this concept, this illustration that Jesus uses teaches an important concept that for whatever reason has fallen by the wayside in so many churches in our day. And it is something that we do need to keep at the forefront. We do need to be mindful of, because Jesus makes a point of it as well. He says, this is something important that I need you guys to understand. Therefore, we need to keep it at the forefront as well. Final verse is verse 11. Judas is the one that comes into focus here in verse 11. For he knew who would betray him, Judas. Therefore, he said, you are not all clean. That's a you plural. Ye, if you're reading in King James, ye are not all clean. And so he's identifying that Judas was not saved, or we could say Judas was not born again. He had not trusted in Jesus the way the rest of the disciples had. He was still in rejection. A final note here as we wrap up this morning. I mentioned as we began this little towel that I was given, and one of the aspects of kind of a ceremonial observance in some church circles is foot washing. That is something that there are churches out there that believe that is more or less a command. It is something that they should be doing. And I can appreciate the desire behind that. Unfortunately, we don't see this really continued on in the New Testament beyond this occasion here in John 13. So I'm not sure this is a requirement or a act that is to be replicated in itself. I would say that it can be. But there's what's important here is not so much this specific practice that Jesus was using as a teaching illustration, but so much as it is a principle that can be taken forth and applied to a variety of settings and ways. And what the lesson is here is so important and so profound, and that is taking on the role of a servant. You know, one of the things that I've just kind of started doing, I mentioned the kids coaching soccer, is before they leave the field, I've told them I want them to go around and pick up trash and just throw it away. And they looked at me like I was crazy. Like, why would we pick up trash? So, you know, one thing is you want to leave the field looking nicer than you found it. But also, for me as a coach, I want to see, are they willing to do it? What's their attitude? Are they too proud? No, you know, there's going to be plenty of other people who can come along and do that. Or just, okay, I don't understand why, but okay. You know, just simple things like that. You know, we have opportunities all around us to do profound things, big things, small things, simple things, things that maybe don't get accolades, that don't get noticed. The principle in play here is taking on the work of a servant. If the King of the universe can do it, you and I can do it. And that's God's desire for each one of us. With that, let's close this morning with, again, this talks about a close personal relationship, the taking care of sin as it comes in, but there's the underlying cleansing, bathing, that comes through our response to Jesus Christ and Him going as the greatest servant of all to lay down His very life, to go to the cross, to die as our substitute in our place, to sacrifice His own life so that we could live. He is the hero of all heroes. He's the greatest of all. He's the one who came to die for all of us, for you and for me. He loved us so much that He laid down His life for you and for me on that cross. What's going to be our response to that? Do we want to accept that cleansing? Do we want to accept that ultimate gift of service? Or are we going to say, no, you're not going to wash me. No, you're not going to bathe me clean. I pray that each and every one of you and me, everyone watching online, that you will recognize that today is the day. If you've never made that decision before, today is the day to trust and to receive. And that may be, you know, a lot of unknown. Maybe it's, you know, well, I don't understand maybe what is entailed in that, and I don't know what that could mean for my life, and I don't understand the full complexity of the theology behind what was done, and that's okay. The message is a simple one. It is receive. It is accept what was done for you by Jesus Christ on the cross, the Savior who couldn't love you any more than He did by laying down His life for you. If you will receive that gift of salvation, of Jesus' sacrifice for you on the cross, He would go to the cross, He wouldn't stay dead, He couldn't stay in the ground, He rose again to new life, He was resurrected. The one who died, was buried, and rose again did that for you. Will you trust Him? Will you accept His gift of salvation? Will you be born again today? Let's close in prayer. Father, thank You for this time we've had in this wonderful study, this example of Your Son. Lord, I pray that we would take our marching orders from this passage, that we would take it seriously, that we would desire to serve others, that we would be okay with taking on the role of Your servant. If the God of the universe can take on the lowliest role of a servant, then can we all as well? Lord, I pray that we can and that we will. And in doing so, that we will honor You as the greatest servants of others. Thank You for the example of Your Son, the greatest servant of all, for His powerful ministry, testimony, example, and His love and His service. Lord, thank you for sending him to the cross to die for each one of us. Bless us now as we go from here. Help us to apply what we've learned this morning. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Please stand with us as we close.
Yours, O Lord, is the greatness and the power and the glory and the victory and the majesty. Indeed, everything that is in the heavens and the earth, yours is the dominion, O Lord, and you exalt yourself as head over all. Both riches and honor come from you, and you rule over all, and in your hand is power and might, and it lies in your hand to make great and to strengthen everyone. Now, therefore, our God, we thank you and praise your glorious name. Amen.